Hey everyone, and welcome to Boston Auto Plug. Over the last 6 to 8 months, we have featured a number of Subarus on this channel. But one video that I've been dying to make and really been waiting for a long time is to have the opportunity to feature both a Forester and Outback and do a head-to-head comparison. I spent a while at my desk figuring out exactly what trims I want to go with for this comparison, because when you look at the Forester and Outback and you look at their prices and their trims, you could do numerous comparisons from the mid $20,000 price range to the mid $30,000 price range. However, for this video, I wanted to go with a top trim Forester. And this is the Touring at a price of $35,600. Now, my reasoning for choosing the Touring really comes down to the fact that if you can spend $35,600 for a Forester, you might actually be able to buy a well-equipped Outback. Now, the Outback I chose for this video is the Limited. And I know what you're saying. I know what you're thinking already. Why are you doing a Touring versus a Limited? Wouldn't it make more sense to do a Touring versus a Touring? Now, to go with the Touring model for the Outback, you're looking at paying around $37,000, $38,000. So now you're looking at a $2,000 or $3,000 difference. However, the Outback I have today with me right now has the optional package with the moonroof and also the navigation system with the 11.6-inch touchscreen for a grand total of $36,500. So when you look at it on paper, there's only a $900 difference, which makes it perfect if you're looking to buy a car around $35,000 to $36,000. So in this video, we're gonna take an in-depth look at both these models, see what their similarities and differences are, and also see if the Forester and Outback is the perfect vehicle for you. Now, before we get in this video, I'd like to thank Subaru of Wakefield in Wakefield, Massachusetts for allowing me to do this review. Their link will be in the description below so you can check out their extensive Subaru inventory. Due to the circumstances, the showroom is not open to customers to help stop the spread of COVID-19. However, that doesn't mean you can't buy your new Subaru from the comforts of your own home. By visiting the Subaru of Wakefield website, you can take advantage of the virtual, non-contact buying experience, where you can research both new and used cars at the dealership, check out the online inventory, and find the perfect car for you. It's a simple, hassle-free, and convenient way to buy online, and Subaru of Wakefield offers a list of great services to help you buy your new or used vehicle. The dealership will also offer a virtual walk-around of the car you're interested in. So just like we're doing right now on Boston Auto Blog, you can check out the car and buy it from your couch or even your bed. So you don't have to leave your house to buy a car, which is amazing. So definitely check out what Subaru's offering right now. They have a huge selection of inventory from new and used cars. So right now is the perfect time to buy a new car. And so, without wasting any further time, let's get right into this comparison. It's no secret that Subaru leads the way when it comes to providing standard all-wheel drive to all their passenger vehicles, especially their highly coveted crossovers. More importantly for consumers, however, is that they have two options on the market from the Japanese manufacturer, with the Forester and Outback both having a similar price tag that spans from the mid-$20,000 to mid-$30,000 price range. Despite the many similarities, they differ quite a bit, offering two unique driving experiences. But for most consumers, this comparison can leave buyers contemplating for hours on which one to choose. Starting off with the exterior dimensions, the Forester comes in with a length of 182 inches, a width of 71.5 inches, and a height of 68 inches. Its traditional SUV road presence and more squared off angles gives the Forester an ample amount of interior room and cargo space, which we'll check out later in this video. Just like its sibling, the Forester boasts a best-in-class 8.7 inches of ground clearance, which is perfect for winter and off-road driving. When taking a look at the Outback, its longer wheelbase and rugged station wagon-like appearance offers a sleek profile, one that's not common amongst its competitors. You're looking at a length of 191 inches, a width of 73 inches, and a height of 66 inches. For the avid adventurer, the Outback comes standard with retractable crossbars, which isn't offered on the Forester from the factory. This provides convenience, but also immediate practicality and versatility for buyers ready to gear up and take on Mother Nature the minute they drive off the lot. However, with all that being said, thanks to its crossover and squared-off design, The Forester is actually the better off-roader when it comes to elevation changes, thanks to its approach and departure angles. When taking a look at the road presence and exterior of both vehicles, the Forester is more civilianized, with minimal plastic cladding, which is typical of most modern-day compact crossovers. On the flip side, it could be argued that Subaru has always marketed the Outback as being the all-terrain, do-everything vehicle, as the plastic cladding found not only on the front and rear bumpers, but also the side sills on the lower portion of the doors insinuates durability. The station wagon-like design cues brings a unique feel to a mundane crossover segment, and surely that's played a factor in its popularity here in the United States. Pinpointing some aesthetics and features, the Forester Touring and Outback Limited will be equipped with steering-responsive LED headlights and LED fog lights for improved illumination during evening drives on dimly lit roads, but also to make driving in adverse weather conditions much safer. Both models will also have folding side mirrors with turn signal indicators and blind spot detection, and will also be equipped with Subaru's EyeSight Driver Assist technology that gives owners an added sense of safety when driving their families to and from destinations. And rounding out the exterior, the Forester and Outback we have today are sitting on 18-inch alloy wheels, which are an upgrade over the 17s you'll find on lower trims. For performance, the Forester and Outback we have today are equipped with a 2.5-liter boxer 4-cylinder engine that puts out 182 horsepower and 176 pound-feet of torque, and is paired with a CVT. If you prefer a more powerful engine, the Outback offers a 2.4-liter turbocharged boxer 4-cylinder, which provides 260 horsepower and 277 pound-feet of torque. Giving both crossovers a competitive advantage against their rivals, Subaru's symmetrical all-wheel drive system comes standard. However, where they differ is in towing capacity, as the Outback can tow up to 2,700 pounds, whereas the Forester can only tow up to 1,500 pounds. For fuel economy, both come in with an identical 26 miles per gallon in the city and 33 miles per gallon on the highway. Inside the Forester Touring and Outback Limited, you'll be greeted by power-adjustable heated leather seats for both the driver and passenger. Between the two, the Outback will be the only model offering ventilated seats, but you'll be paying a little extra for the touring trim if that's a must-have feature. As you glance over to the dashboard and infotainment system, that's where the significant differences will determine whether you prefer a modern layout or a traditional user interface. Like most of the models in the Subaru lineup, the Forester will have a secondary 6.3-inch multi-information display. From here, you can monitor your fuel economy, outside temperature and weather, interior climate control temperature, and turn-by-turn navigation, among a list of other features to help enhance your driving experience when behind the wheel. Below, an 8-inch touchscreen with Apple CarPlay and Android Auto compatibility will provide a user-friendly experience. You'll get onboard navigation to go along with a 9-speaker Harman Kardon premium audio system so you and your passengers can enjoy listening to music while on road trips. The physical buttons and rotary dials for the dual-zone climate control are perfect for consumers who aren't interested in big touchscreens and also newer tech features, like we'll see in the Outback. As always, you'll get a rear backup camera with trajectory to go along with rear cross-traffic alert and rear automatic braking. The Outback, on the other hand, comes with an 11.6-inch touchscreen that modernizes the interior, while also adding an upscale look that resembles similar layouts found in new Volvo and Tesla vehicles. Personally, I find this setup to be more appealing, as there's no button clutter and the design is very cleanly laid out. Resolution and graphics are good, and just like in the Forester, you will get Apple CarPlay and Android Auto compatibility, and also a 12-speaker Harman Kardon audio system. Just like in the Forester, you'll have enhanced safety features, such as rear automatic braking and the standard rear backup camera. The Outback will also offer an optional wireless phone charging pad, which is not available on the Forester, but more importantly, adding convenience for the driver. Subaru's X mode can be found in both models, so buyers who plan to take on winter conditions and the off-road will have the peace of mind and terrain management to tackle whatever Mother Nature throws at them. Above, on the Forester, a panoramic moonroof will let in a lot of natural light, whereas the Outback will receive just a standard moonroof. Now, for passengers in the back, we're going to start off with the Forester. Now, I want to point out that the Forester is actually the more practical of the two by about a cubic foot or 1.3 cubic feet of passenger volume. So when it comes to rear legroom, I have plenty of room. Sitting behind myself, now I'm 5'5", so I'm not the tallest person out there, but I think if you're around 6 foot tall and you're sitting behind somebody around like 5'5", 5'6", maybe even 5'7", you're gonna be very comfortable. On top of that is the fact that because you have a higher roof line, you don't need to worry about rear headroom as much. So headroom is not gonna be much of an issue for taller passengers, but the real difference though between the Forester and the Outback is the person who's gonna be sitting in the middle. Now, for the center seat, the rear hump is not very aggressive at all. So the Forester, in my mind, is more conducive for somebody or for a family of five. So if you have a third person in the center, this actually totally works. Especially if you have even a little older kids around 8, 9, 10 years old, I think that this actually works because I'm not going to be cramped depending on how tall the people on either side of me are. But if you're strictly going to have kids back here, they're going to be just fine. They have plenty of room to work with. They're not going to be cramped. The person in the center is not going to be complaining about how, you know, they're not very comfortable. Because in reality, for me, even at 5'5", I don't feel like I'm being impeded upon when it comes to my rear legroom. So this is actually very comfortable. And then on the passenger side, I just see a little bit further back, it's a little more reclined, and I still have room to work with. So for the Forester, overall, when it comes to headroom, legroom, this might actually be more conducive for a family, but more importantly, if you always have three people in the back, the person in the center is going to be a lot happier in the Forester than the Outback, which we're going to check out in a minute. Also, for passengers in the back, on the Touring for the Forester, you're going to get two level heated seats, two rear air vents, two USB inputs, and also a center armrest with two cup holders. Moving on to the Outback, I have plenty of legroom to work with. So I think either way, Forester or the Outback, legroom is not gonna be the issue. It really comes down to headroom, but also rear legroom for the passenger in the center. Now, headroom I notice immediately because the Forester is really a crossover, whereas the Outback, even though it's considered a crossover, has more of a station wagon-like design and body line. So, of course, you are going to be sacrificing rear headroom. But that isn't really the big thing that I think people should be focusing on. It really is the center seat. Now, the rear hump is pretty much more aggressive than the Forester. So in my mind and in my opinion, a family of five is better suited for the Forester. So if you have younger kids and you're not ready for the ascent yet, the Forester is the better option to go with because the rear hump is not very aggressive at all. And I think for kids or even just passengers in the back, they're gonna be more comfortable, particularly for the person in the center. Now the Outback in my mind is better for people who have just two people in the back all the time. So if you have maybe just two children, this would be the better way to go. Forester is better for a growing family, but also if rear headroom is a priority, Forester is definitely going to take the point on this one. And then for rear legroom on the passenger side, once again, I have plenty of legroom, so I wouldn't be complaining. And again, I don't think rear legroom is going to be an issue, whether you choose the Forester or the Outback. It just really comes down to what is the better fit for your lifestyle, but also what's better fit for your family. And I think for a bigger family, the Forester is the way to go, especially if you are growing. Maybe if you're not ready for that ascent yet, the Forester definitely should be the one you choose. The Outback is really for that more mature family, maybe just a family of four, and also a family that always is going on longer cruises, longer drives, because I think the Outback is actually a lot more comfortable, especially when it comes to interior trim quality and just, you know, soft touch padding. I like the Outback more for its quality, its interior quality and design, whereas the Forester is more purpose built and better for families. Now, I chose the Limited for this comparison because you do get two rear air vents, two level heated seats, two USB inputs. So this is actually rather fair. I've noticed a lot of comparisons on the internet where they compare one trim of the Forester and one trim of the Outback, and the Forester is the one with the two rear air vents, whereas the Outback does not have it because they chose either a base model or a premium trim. Whereas this is more, in my mind, fair. It's a more fair comparison because you have the exact same features, you have the exact same leather trim seats, so it's fair. Also, pricing is almost identical, just a mere $900 difference. So when it comes to features, not much is different. It just comes down to what is the better fit for your family. And then rounding out the rear seating area, you do have two cup holders and a center armrest. So we are now at my favorite part of this comparison, which is the rear cargo space. And you're probably asking, Mike, you're a car enthusiast. Don't you care about performance numbers, interior quality, leather seats, even technology? How can this be the best part of the video for you? Well, back in November, I talked about how the Subaru Outback is a victim of the new standards of measurement by the Society of Automotive Engineers. And with that, from the 2019 to 2020 model year, somehow the Outback loses 3 cubic feet of rear cargo space on paper, despite the fact that it's actually a little bit larger than the last generation. Now, with the Forester, it's in the midst of its life cycle, so there is no application for the rear cargo space when it comes to the new standards of measurement. However, that isn't the case anymore, because in April of 2020, the day I'm filming this, the Forester now has a new standards of measurement of rear cargo room, so on paper, the Outback now seems to be the more practical one. So starting off with the Forester, you can expect to receive 29 cubic feet of rear cargo, which actually is around 2.5 to 3 cubic feet less than the prior model year. So on paper, there is a difference because of that new standards of measurement, but in reality, you're losing nothing. What I like the most about the Forester, and probably more than the Outback, is its traditional crossover look and also the traditional crossover roofline. So you can fit a lot more in terms of height. Now, what I think, though, is that the Forester is more conducive for a family that has a pet. So if you have a bigger dog, maybe you're carrying some of the items that he has with him. I actually think this is better, especially if you are more of an avid adventurer, someone that has a lot of stuff they're carrying with them that piles up. In terms of height, it's better, but also what I like the most too is that when you fold the rear seats down, it's nice and flat, so you can fit skiing equipment, any type of gear you have with you. So in my mind, even though there really is a 3 cubic foot difference between the Forester and Outback, I personally, when it comes to day-to-day life and just, you know, carrying stuff with you, or if you have a pet, the Forester might actually be the better option to go with. Now moving on to the Outback, you're going to get 32.5 cubic feet of rear cargo room, which is a 3.5 cubic foot difference from the Forester. Now, one thing to remember though, is that with the Outback and its station wagon-like appearance, you can fit a lot more items in terms of length. So if you have snowboarding gear or skiing gear, you go to the mountains every winter, whether it's New Hampshire, Maine, Vermont, you're gonna be able to carry all that equipment with you. So when the rear seats are folded down, you can just slide that right in and you don't need to worry. What I also like too is that you do have a side pocket, so if any smaller items that you have and you're afraid they're gonna get thrown around, you're gonna store them right in there. So when it comes to the Outback, I think it's better for people who are maybe constantly on the go or going to the mountains for skiing and snowboarding during the winter. But I think either way, whether it's the Outback or the Forester, you can't go wrong when it comes to its practicality. Now, more importantly, as we end this comparison, let's get into the driving environment you can expect behind the wheel of either vehicle. Now, for me, I love the 11.6 inch touchscreen in the Outback. I'm a tech guy, but also it reminds me a lot of what you can expect in a Volvo, the newer Volvos, but also Tesla models as well. There's no button clutter, it's very easy to use, and I just think the resolution and graphics are pretty good. So for me, I like that. I think some people would say I'd rather prefer the smaller touchscreen in the Forester. Also, you get an optional wireless phone charging pad, so that's really convenient, adds some convenience to your driving experience. But as you're going to notice, as you go higher up in the Outback lineup, you're going to notice that the interior is a little more upscale. So you have a lot more soft touch padding along throughout the interior. Really, really nice. I noticed that in the Onyx Edition as well. The trim they used, really, really comfortable. Also, better than what you would expect in, say, a Ford or GM product. And then also, once you go higher up, like the Touring XT trims, you have Napa leather interior, which is really nice. I experienced that in the Legacy. So for me, if you're looking for maybe a luxury driving experience, something a little more comfortable, the Outback is definitely the way to go out of the two. Now, when it comes to the Forester, what I will say is that you get a different perspective and also a different driving experience. In the Outback, it's more of a car-like design. You feel like you're in a car. It's like being in a Legacy. You sit lower to the ground. Whereas the Forester, you're higher up off the ground. You have a little higher seating position. You have a wider field of vision. And I just think overall, if you're looking for a crossover, the Forester is the way to go, especially if you're comparing it to some other competitors in this segment and price range. Also, if you don't like if you don't like bigger touchscreens, you don't like the lack of buttons, the Forester setup is very traditional. You have rotary dials, you have buttons for your infotainment system. So if you prefer that style, the Forester is definitely the way to go. You also have a panoramic moonroof, which lets in a lot of natural light. I love how it bounces off this brown interior. It looks amazing. I've gotten really addicted to this interior color. So at the end of the day, even though we compare the Outback and the Forester, and we can say which one's better for you at $35,000, they might not actually be the same vehicle targeting the same consumer and demographic. Because the Forester, in my mind, is really perfect for a family that's not ready for the Ascent yet. They're growing, but they're not there yet for that Ascent. Maybe they need that extra room for that family pet. And they're just not ready to go in the three-row passenger direction. It's also perfect because at $35,000, it's fully loaded. You get that leather seats, you get the panoramic moonroof, and in my mind, it's just really overall practical. Then for the Outback, and for me personally, I think even at this price range, you're targeting a different consumer because you have that nicer leather interior, soft touch padding. Even on the higher trims, you got a Nappa leather interior. The Outback is really targeting a consumer that might look at an Acura, a Lexus, maybe even a few other luxury brands as well, that is looking for the best value for the price. So around $41,000 for a top trim Outback, you really can't go wrong with it because it's fully loaded. Whereas if you're looking at maybe German or Japanese competitors that are in the luxury segment, then you start sacrificing a bit. So the Outback is really for a different demographic and consumer. But if you are looking for comfort and also that car-like driving experience, then the Outback will be the better decision to go with. But the Forester, in my mind, is the better car for that growing family. So guys, thank you so much for watching this video. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe for more. And I'll see you guys next time.